How can Julia Gillard still be Prime Minister after this week's U-turn on boat people? Go back. In opposition, Gillard attacked the Howard government for sending boat people to Nauru and Manus Island.
Labor will end the Pacific solution because it is costly, unsustainable and wrong as a matter of principle.
And Labor did scrap the Pacific solution 4 years ago. But this week, Gillard announced she'd bring it back.
For heaven's sake, we want to get people to Nauru and PNG for processing.
Gillard was in fact conceding she made a mistake, a catastrophe that's cost 700 lives, $5 billion. Now, I say Gillard's mistake because it was her plan to destroy border policies which had worked.
I was the substantive author of a policy paper which became Labor's policy.
But under Gillard's policy, we've gone from three boats a year to more than three a week. Gillard pretended for years her soft laws weren't to blame.
Can you pretend that the changes that you made had no effect?
Well, Chris, let's be frank about this. There will always be global factors and regional factors that cause people to get on the move.
But this week, Gillard's own panel of experts, led by former Defence Chief Angus Houston, said the opposite was true. Gillard's laws, with boat people processed here, were the cause.
Onshore processing encourages people to jump into boats.
Gillard also used to deny her laws were luring people to their deaths. 3 years ago, I counted the first 25 to die. But when Nationals leader Warren Truss repeated my figure, Gillard said he was irresponsible and vile.
He claimed the government was responsible for people risking their lives in these boats.
Well, Laurie, this is one of the most irresponsible and dangerous statements I think I've heard in Australian politics. Accuse the government of causing the loss of 25 lives. Well, there's no evidence to support this figure.
In fact, Gillard's panel, which is not irresponsible, has since counted hundreds more deaths, which it says is why Gillard's laws must change.
604 people have lost their lives since October 2009. And we were dismayed to learn this morning that another 67 asylum seekers are believed to be missing.
Why did Gillard refuse for so long to admit there was a problem? Too proud to give the opposition the satisfaction.
Why won't the Prime Minister swallow her pride, pick up the phone to the President in Nauru?
I am not intending to waste $1 billion of taxpayers' money on an outcome that we have been advised will not work.
Even when her immigration minister 10 months ago told her to just give in, reopen Nauru, Gillard refused. Since then, another 400 boat people have died or gone missing. How can we have a Prime Minister directly responsible for such a disaster and not have her resign? When the Howard government brought in the Pacific Solution in 2001, no person was more abused by the left than then Immigration Minister Philip Ruddock. Protesters picketed his home, he needed 24-hour protection, and Amnesty International told him to stop wearing its badge. Mr. Ruddock joins me now. Thanks for your time. How tough was it on you and your family bringing in the policies that actually stopped the boats?
Well, I mean, if you're implementing good public policy, it's a matter of, I think, progressing it and moving forward and being prepared to justify what you're doing. Yes, there are people who disagree. It never troubled me a great deal. But I think the extent to which it impacted upon my family was something that I would have rather not seen. I mean, when you're at the Opera House and somebody yells at you as you're going down the stairs, it's not a very pleasant event when it happens, but you know, it was part of the territory, I suspect.
But how did your family in particular go through this period of vilification? It's something else to be called a racist and evil, as you regularly were.
Well, I think my wife felt it very, very keenly. But again, it goes with the territory. I mean, I understand it's the nature of a robust democracy that people won't always agree with you. They'll put their views and sometimes want to put them strongly. I guess the Ruddock family got a degree of vehemence that's not always seen, but, I'm not one who constrains freedom of speech or tries to stand in the way of putting my views or having others put their views to me.
Well, Labor is now sent in the army to have a look at reopening Nauru and Manus Island. Do you feel vindicated?
Look, it's important to understand that the issues that I was dealing with were always ones in which I had a very strong sense of doing the right thing for Australia, but also I've a keen interest in refugees. I'm not about trying to deny protection to people who might be the subject of torture and persecution, but one knows that you're often dealing with people who want to try and achieve outcomes where they may not be their circumstances. And what we're dealing with now is an effort by the government, which has denied that it was necessary, to put in place a robust regime to ensure that we're better able to address the priorities of those who need help most. And sending people offshore was always a measure, in my view, where we could put in place the same sorts of arrangements that the UNHCR uses, that is, the refugee organisation has a process by which it determines claims, has a form of appeal, but you don't get access to judicial review and all the attenuated processes that have caused Australia enormous delay and harm in dealing with these issues domestically. And offshore processing was a way in which you would have a much more robust and, I think, efficacious system in place.
The problem is, though, reopening Nauru. Nauru is planned to hold 1,500 people, and already, since the government announced it, about 500 people have turned up since then. Does this show that it will fail? It's already being overrun.
Look, I think what is clear is that this was never a menu that you can pick and choose from. I think you have to look at all of the measures that the Howard government implemented, and they all need to be brought to bear. I mean, this is a bigger problem than we faced. The way in which the government has dealt with it has brought more smugglers into the operations, more people intent on travelling to Australia. When you look at the figures that have been given for Malaysia, they're talking about 100,000 people there now, as against 20,000 4 years ago.
So is there a risk that Nauru will, in fact, be overrun before it's even built?
Well, one expects that there would be a pipeline, and the pipeline doesn't stop when you immediately make your changes. But in my view, this was never a menu that you can pick and choose from. I think all of the measures that we used, including returning boats when it's safe to do so, including temporary protection visas, a robust system of dealing with claims, ensuring that those who have a requirement for assistance are properly accommodated, but getting out of it the people who are intent on abusing the system is something that has to occur. And as I said, it's not a menu.
Well, you
this
say
is something
that. You
in which all
turning,
of the measures.
You mentioned turning back the boats. Look, in 2001, a freighter called the Tampa, which was bound for Singapore, rescued boat people who used threats to make it bring them to Christmas Island instead. You sent in soldiers to turn around to Nauru. Now, on Monday, the Tampa's sister ship, also bound for Singapore, also rescued boat people who also used threats to make it bring them to Christmas Island instead. But these people were allowed to land. Did Julia Gillard miss her big chance to send a signal as you did in 2001?
Look, I think the instructions should have been very clear. I mean, ships, when they rescue people, are obliged to take them to the nearest port. This vessel was intent on going to Singapore, essentially that's what we found. I think the Tampa was intended to go to Singapore. The Indonesians had agreed that it could offload the people at Merak, convinced the captain by threats, I'm told, of self-harm, but I think they also were very intimidating in relation to the Tampa, and I suspect in relation to this vessel. But in my view, the more we acquiesce in relation to these matters, the more the people involved believe that they can stand over us to achieve their outcomes.
Philip Ruddock, thank you so much for joining us.